Whoa, don't eat that!
What's going on here?
Today, let's look at 10 dangerous cookie mistakes that could kill you. Okay, yes, cooking can be a tough skill to master, but it should never come to this.
Don't even think about it, pal!
Not having basic knife skills.
Whoa, you're gonna let me use this knife?
Whether it's in a professional kitchen or simply at home cooking for your family, the number one thing to remember is to always hold your knives properly. It's the most essential and safest rule to follow in any cooking situation. Not only will it speed up the process and make it more fun, but it'll also keep you safe from silly injuries. Most knife cuts and lacerations are caused by chopping food the wrong way, and around 350,000 people are injured by kitchen knives every year. Not knowing basic knife skills is one of the most common mistakes people make when they cook, and it's also one of the most dangerous. If you think you can just pick up a knife and wing it, think again. That's how accidents happen.
It was an accident.
To avoid a trip to the ER, remember this. Whenever you chop something and you need to stabilize it with your non-dominant hand, always curl your fingertips under your knuckles and guide the knife with the tips of your knuckles. And for the hand that's holding the knife, your index finger should be partly touching the blade in order to stabilize the chopping, your thumb should be extended and resting firmly against the blade, and the rest of your fingers should be tucked under the handle. This simple yet useful technique will come in handy every time, and will reduce your risk of accidentally chopping off your fingers.
Ah! My finger!
Using the wrong knives.
It's not a knife.
Yeah, that's a knife.
No, it is a knife.
Now that you've figured out how to hold your knife and have avoided being a public danger, it's important to keep it functional. You see, everybody has knives in their kitchen, but not everyone has or even knows the importance of a knife sharpener. Having really sharp knives might be scary for some, especially those who aren't too comfortable with cooking yet, but in reality, sharp knives are way safer than old, dull knives. The duller a knife is, the more pressure you need to use to chop your stuff. And the more pressure you use, the less control you have over the knife, which can result in very unfortunate chopping incidents. If your knife is sharp, on the other hand, you need less brute force, which means it's safer and obviously faster.
I'd like a bigger knife, a big, long, sharp knife. That's what I'm in the market for.
Not only is sharpening your knife an important cooking skill to have to ensure your safety, but it's also helpful to not damage your food. For instance, chopping delicate ingredients like herbs with a sharp knife will make them look fresher for longer, as opposed to with a dull knife, which will accelerate wilting and discoloration. Many things can dull a knife, but knife abuse is the most common one. Abuse includes putting it in the dishwasher, storing it loose in a drawer, or leaving it on a cluttered countertop. The best way to avoid dull knives is to store them in a knife block or any other suitable holder.
I like to keep mine razor sharp, too. Sharp enough you can shave with them.
Cross-contaminating.
It's horrible. We can't stop the oil from contaminating everything.
One of the most important things to remember while you're cooking is to always wash your station, knives, and hands after handling raw meat. Usually, at restaurants, this kind of cross-contamination would be highly punishable and could even result in the restaurant shutting down altogether. At home, however, even though it's not monitored as closely, the rules still apply. Unless you want to get very sick, when you're prepping any kind of uncooked meat, always wash your hands before touching anything else. Cross-contamination occurs when bacteria from raw meat are transferred to cooked foods or surfaces. These bacteria can cause serious foodborne illnesses and food poisoning when ingested, and can be dangerous to your health.
No! Germs! Germs! Everywhere!
The CDC estimates that around 48 million people get sick from cross-contamination every year in the United States, with about 128,000 hospitalizations and 3,000 deaths from foodborne diseases. The best tip to avoid getting sick is to wash your countertops and cutting boards thoroughly, and if possible, have two separate cutting boards, one for raw meat and one for everything else. Another piece of advice, always store your raw meat on the bottom shelf in your fridge. That way, if the package leaks, it won't contaminate the rest of your food.
We're going to outsmart it!
Your defrosting method.
Yeah, I mean, lately I've just been using it to defrost meat.
Defrosting your meat can be a bit of a hassle, especially on busy weeknights when time is of the essence. The best way to ensure your meat will be properly thawed in time for dinner is to put it in the fridge overnight. A common mistake that a lot of people unknowingly make is to defrost the meat on the counter. That's a big no-no. It's certainly tempting, as it will obviously be faster, but the risk of bacteria development simply isn't worth the few hours saved. As your meat, poultry, or seafood reaches room temperature, bacteria can multiply a lot faster than in the refrigerator. Another mistake? Thawing it in the microwave.
I tried to defrost a chicken in the microwave.
Since microwaves don't usually heat up evenly, you will most likely put the meat into the danger zone and overcook certain parts of the meat, which can lead to, once again, bacteria multiplying. If the fridge takes too long for you, notably if you forgot to take it out the day before, then there's another way to speed up the process. You can place your meat in a sealed plastic bag and put it in a bowl of cold water. Yes, cold, not hot water, as it could also prematurely start the cooking process. If that's still does not suit you, you can always cook your meat without defrosting it at all, but just know that it will probably make your cooking time about 50% longer. Whatever you do, don't leave your stuff on the counter.
Yeah, I'll defrost in a couple days. No harm, no foul.
Not wearing the right clothes.
Look what I'm wearing!
Okay, yes, wearing the classic white chef's hat can look pretty awesome, but that's not what we mean when we talk about wearing the right kind of clothes for cooking. You don't have to wear an entire professional chef's outfit whenever you enter the kitchen, but there are still some things you should be aware of before making your wardrobe choices. After all, who wants to randomly catch on fire because they wanted to be fashionable? The first thing to keep in mind is to steer clear of long sleeves as much as possible. While they can be helpful to protect your arms, if they're not properly rolled up, your chance of starting a fire becomes pretty high. Do you know the other thing that's highly flammable? Your hair.
This hair is... what is that?
If you have long hair, you should always tie it back, not only to avoid a fire, but also to avoid the awkwardness of someone finding a hair in their food. Fire departments have a yearly estimated average of 172,900 fires started by cooking, and those represent around 44% of home fires. Another major faux pas in kitchen fashion is to wear shoes with open toes. Many accidents can happen due to wearing improper footwear, boiling liquid dropping on your foot, a slip and a fall, or simply a knife drop. How unfortunate would it be to drop a knife on your foot and then have no little piggy left to go to the market? Just think of Chandler's pinky toe next time you want to make dinner with the wrong shoes.
You know, I have always been intrigued by flip-flops.
Improper sanitation.
Should we wash our hands?
If the arrival of the pandemic last year has taught us anything, it's that adopting basic sanitary practices are imperative. And while this goes for everything you do in life, in the kitchen it's even more important. You shouldn't wash your hands only when you handle raw meat, but every single time you step into the kitchen, especially if you're coming back from the grocery store or somewhere outside. It's the best way to avoid spreading germs and bacteria to other people. Warm water and soap are both necessary before and after you've prepared your food. Even though that's kind of old news, some people take this crucial step for granted.
We're tired of you taking us for granted.
But washing your hands isn't the only thing you can do to keep proper sanitation standards in your kitchen. Frequently replacing your sponges and dish rags can greatly help. We're all guilty of leaving that one sponge on the edge of the sink and watching it disintegrate in front of us. Just like it absorbs water and liquids, it also absorbs a pretty significant amount of bacteria, which will later spread to your dishes. Most experts will recommend changing your dishwashing accessories at least once a week to minimize the damage. It might seem like a frivolous and useless thing to do, but in reality, it's a huge step to keep your cooking space as safe as possible.
Not if you understand.
Incorrect leftover storage.
Sheldon, there are two dumplings left. Do you want them?
Whenever you have a bunch of food left and you've packed it away in some Tupperware, what do you do next? Do you put it immediately in the fridge, or do you let it cool down a bit before you stick it in there? Well, logically, you probably wait a few minutes or even a few hours. You don't want everything in your fridge to get too hot, right? But in reality, that's a very, very dangerous thing to do. According to Stop Foodborne Illness, if food is left on the counter at a temperature between 41 degrees and 140 degrees for more than 2 hours, it becomes a breeding ground for bacteria.
Flesh-eating bacteria.
This range of temperature is considered a danger zone, as food should always be above 165 degrees, or in this case, stored in your fridge. The bacteria, which can double in numbers under 20 minutes, can cause serious food poisoning and illnesses if eaten. So the best thing to do when you're done eating your food, just put it in the fridge right away in smaller containers, since small containers have more surface area, which leads to quicker cooling. Then just make sure you eat your leftovers within 3 to 4 days, and you should be safe.
Nickel off on expired baby food.
Sold!
Not using the right equipment.
And don't blame the equipment. The equipment is good. It's Acme equipment.
There are tons of kitchen hacks that you can find online to help you save a bit of time or make better use of what time you do have. You're out of eggs? Don't worry, there's a trick for that. You don't have a can opener? There's also a trick for that. Still, even though there are tons of hacks, there are also tons of ways to hurt yourself if you use them incorrectly. If you ever find yourself without any oven mitts, don't try to replace them with something else. Most people will use tea towels or dish rags for practically anything, like cleaning up spills or drying the dishes. But under no circumstances should they be used to take your burning hot food out of the oven.
Now, Fred, you stay away from this oven.
Depending on your towel, the material will probably not be thick enough to prevent your food from burning you. And if that rag is wet, hello the burns. Since water can easily transmit heat, and this heat turns the dampness into steam, you will most likely end up with a steamy, burning, and useless rag that can cause some serious burns. Having dry oven mitts in good condition is a must in every kitchen, and underestimating their value is one of the biggest mistakes people make when cooking.
Oven mitts! Wow, thanks, Mom!
Leaving the food unattended.
Well, I was starving, so I stole some food.
No matter if you're preparing a quick bite to eat or a major feast, your attention should always be focused on what's happening in the kitchen. Forget doing laundry or taking out the trash. Cooking should be your main focal point. While yes, multitasking and going on about your day might be tempting, leaving your food unattended can be very dangerous and cause a lot of damage. This is especially true if you're frying, grilling, boiling, or broiling food, as these cooking techniques require more immediate attention. But don't get us wrong, even if you're simply simmering, baking, or even roasting something, a responsible person is still required to watch over the food to avoid any unfortunate incident.
What happened?
I don't know. The water caught on fire.
All it takes is a breeze, a mischievous pet, or even a young child to come into the kitchen and catastrophe can occur. In addition to keeping your attention on what you're doing, you should always keep flammable objects like cloths, wooden utensils, and food packaging away from the stovetop. Always be ready in case of emergency. Have a lid nearby to smother any small grease fires, and spend some dough on a fire extinguisher. Staying alert and prepared is the best way to create a safe cooking space and reduce the risk of accidents.
Two options. You either follow my rules or follow my rules.
Cookware and temperature.
Temperature level rising.
Cookware is the most important thing you need when you want to make a meal, and with so many options, it can be hard to keep track of how to maintain everything properly. While most cookware can simply be used at will, there are some that require a bit more guidance, like glass cookware. You know, those big glass containers you use to bake chicken in the oven or make a hearty casserole in? Well, even though these are usually designed to withstand extreme hot or cold temperatures, if you don't handle them the right way, you'll most likely end up breaking them.
I told you you're gonna break those toys!
For example, if you just took the glass plate out of the oven, putting it directly in the fridge or under cold water, or the opposite, it could cause some serious shattering. Just like many substances, glass can expand and shrink as the temperature changes. And if it changes too quickly, it goes kaboom. To avoid shattering your glassware, you should never add liquid when it's hot, nor place it on surfaces that risk being wet. Plus, always let it cool down or warm up before refrigerating or heating.
I did everything right.
Try out more great videos. Just tap or click. First time here? Then leave us a comment, hit that subscribe button, and ring that notification bell.